Holiday Talk Star Special, Bryan Neiman, Dan Joseph, C4, and Tori Snow here talking about the big stories of 2022. You know, Time Magazine does its Person of the Year. And if you did one locally for the city of Baltimore, I think you have a couple of names that would come out there. I think Ivan Bates would be one. Mm-hmm. I think maybe Marilyn Mosby would be one. Maybe Brandon Scott. Maybe even Tharu Vignaraja. But I think you would give it to the squeegee kid, right? With the squeegee or the local person of the year, would it be the squeegee?
You laugh. Absolutely. But I could see them being woke like that.
Well, it's.
I mean, they are very significant.
Oh,
they
have a huge impact. Huge story
that's
this year.
That's what Time's Person of the Year is, right? It's who had the biggest impact. And I think all of us, the thing we talked about the most, that had the most impact when it comes to callers, when it comes to texters, was the squeegee kids. That was the thing that got people the most riled up, especially after Timothy Reynolds.
When you think about the fact that we had, after the Squeegee Collaborative met, just to show you the impact on the city, after they met and came out with their recommendations of what they were going to do, a 19-year-old arrested at his corner with a gun on them, it just reinforced just how dangerous all this stuff is and how the minimizing of it occurred throughout the year, where it's just, you know, they're trying to earn a living and they're out there. Yeah, they're out there and some of them are robbing people. And in Timothy Reynolds' case, he was shot and killed.
Yeah. See, before we talk about, you know, where we're going and what happened this year, why does Baltimore have this problem? I mean, educate us on how this is still an issue in Baltimore, decades and decades of squeegeeing, when other cities don't have this.
I do have to educate, once again, as the mayor and everybody else, we have not had four straight decades of this problem, no matter how loud people say it, whatever volume. We had this problem in the 1980s. And as we entered into the early 1990s, you know how it went away? Police officers went around and took the squeegee stick and the buckets from the kids. Oh, horrible. You mean they physically? Yeah, they gave them a choice.
They said,
either you give me this stuff or I'm arresting you. And they gave up the stick and the bucket. It was a different attitude back then. And that went away. We did not have, if you go back in your mind after the riots following the death of Freddie Gray in 2015-16, we weren't talking about squeegee kids. Yeah. We were talking about vagrants. We were talking about, remember the case of the woman that we thought was stabbed by a homeless person? Oprah even got involved with it.
Yes,
and her husband and the stepdaughter ended up doing it.
Panhandlers.
We weren't talking. The squeegee phenomenon to the degree, I'm not saying it was 100% away, to the degree we're talking about it now, really started in 2017-18, as we saw this mayor, Catherine Pugh gave them a name. Remember the squeegee corps? Mm. She actually like gave it a status. And then after that, Jack Young and now Brandon Scott have kind of formalized this whole squeegee thing. So this whole phenomenon, we had it. New York City had it. New Jersey had it. Other places had squeegee kids doing things. But it was not to the degree it is now. For decades. It wasn't.
In many ways, Baltimore legitimized it, right? Like I can't remember a time when you had people from the mayor's office advocating and saying these people are just making a living.
Well, Catherine Pugh did that. She called it the squeegee corps.
And 1985, right, when this was an issue the last time, you had they did this. Some members of the city council tried to do the same thing and turn this into a social justice issue. They tried to make it a social justice issue. They failed that time. This time they succeeded in making this a social justice issue, and everybody in the city council and the mayor seems to be on board.
But once again, I drove up to New York. My sister lived in Harlem for a while. I drove up there. You had squeegee men and kids up in New York on a regular basis at traffic lights and everything else. So it wasn't just a Baltimore phenomenon. Yeah. But other places decided we're going to stop this activity.
I can
remember, we're not going to allow this.
In my mind, as a young kid, I must have been like 12 years old in the mid-1980s, going to New York City for the first time with my dad. And he drove me into New York. And I saw a hooker for the first time, a prostitute. And it was shocking.
A worker.
And I actually remember it more from that trip to New York that I had than all the other times I went to Baltimore, which I did go on a regular basis.
I remember when
Times
Square, you could not be down there at dark. Times Square was horrible at night.
It was a different place. New York was just a different place.
It's getting back there.
Yeah. Oh, it might be, but they cleaned it up so significantly.
Yeah. It was, and maybe we'll talk a little bit more about that, the transformation of New York and, you know, if it happened there, why couldn't it happen here in Baltimore? But to the squeegee point, here we are. We've been dealing with it for a couple of years. People are tired of it. We've seen all kinds of incidents with motorists. It has certainly, at least anecdotally, keeping people from coming into Baltimore from the suburbs. I mean, you even hear city residents, black city residents, who will say, I don't want to deal with this
crap
either.
How about a black
either.
Woman carrying a gun that lived in the city at the corner of Martin Luther King and Washington Boulevard? That doesn't get enough talk. Everybody talks about how white county people don't like the squeegee kids. African-American 42-year-old woman living in the city carrying a gun that got confronted by a squeegee kid at Washington Boulevard and Martin Luther King, and yet the picture or the face of this is some white county person.
That so the mayor, I feel, always hides behind this constitutional crisis that they have, or whether or not they are allowed to kick people off. But you've got lawyers from every side of the aisle that say, nah, you know what? If they walk into the middle of the street, you can totally stop.
What did Ivan Bates tell us?
Ivan Bates says you can do this. So why is it still an issue? Why do we have to have a collaborative? I believe is we had to have the collaborative because the mayor really doesn't want to be the one that pushes them off the street.
Yeah, right? Well, I mean, again, the whole point is to legitimize it and to give it a face, right? To give it a name, to say, you know, to paint the image that these are people that are, you know, they're trying to feed their baby sister, got to buy some milk on the way home. And ultimately it is leading to what we're getting, which is like universal basic income. That's their end game argument, is that we need more resources for families so that they're not out there doing mischievous
things.
Well,
I believe
things.
They floated, and I know this was a kid. The media didn't get this off. They floated paying squeegee kids not to squeegee just to see what the reaction would be.
Yeah.
And when they got tremendous blowback, that's when the mayor came out and said, no, it was never our intent to pay them just not to squeegee. We intended to pay them to go to training and that type of thing. I believe that to my core, that they just wanted to see how bad will this be if we say we're paying them not to squeegee.
Like I said, though, this is primarily being addressed as a social justice issue by Brandon Scott. He believes, and I think he's listening to activists who say you cannot arrest these young black men and put them in jail for just squeegeeing. And he's listening to them, and he's not doing his job as a result.
But you don't have to arrest your way out of it. That's why I continue to say the whole issue is whether or not you allow somebody to walk in the middle of traffic. And we don't do that. Kevin Davis, Baltimore City Police Commissioner Kevin Davis, when the protests are going after Freddie Gray, you saw I-83, I don't know if you heard about this, they blocked I-83 here, wouldn't allow traffic to come off, all this type of stuff. And Kevin Davis took over from Anthony Batts and said, if you go out in traffic, we're going to arrest you. And guess what? They stopped blocking traffic.
Yeah.
You don't block traffic anymore. So you don't have to totally arrest your way out of it if you let people know what the consequence is going to be. Everybody don't want to go to jail.
Well, look, take the squeegees away, right? Do what you did last time. Or start fining the motorists for giving them money. There are other ways around this so you don't have to arrest your way out of, but Brandon Scott doesn't want to do any of those things.
Well, in many ways, he wants to be the cool mayor too, right? And that's a factor, and I think that's a bit of a challenge, right? He wants to be liked by the squeegee kids, which is why, I mean, he listens to them, right? And I mean, I'm not against having conversations, but they didn't have cameras in the hearings because the squeegee kids didn't want cameras.
Well, not
there,
just that, you
right?
had the and, corporate community in there with them.
Yeah.
That's the thing that I don't understand, like, having dealt with this so long. You had huge businesses in Baltimore sitting at that table with them, acknowledging or you know, enabling.
It's legitimate,
which is
and
crazy because they're killing their businesses. That's what I'm saying.
Well, and I think that the mayor wants to be popular, right? He wants to be liked. He doesn't want to be the mayor that does things that mayors have to do, right? Enforce the law. You know, it's like being the hall monitor at school, right? It's not fun.
But it's
right?
not just that. It's his background. Look, before he became a city councilman, he worked in a youth center helping kids when it comes to truancy in terms of not going to class. So his whole background, he's never had a job like out in the real world. Uh-huh. He's always worked in some capacity with young people and doing things like this. So that's the prism that he uses
to approach
this
stuff.
He believes
the carrot is the most important
thing,
and the stick should probably be as small as possible. Mm-hmm. And that's the way he's done this. Listen, if you have a motorist who is shot and killed in the middle of the day after three other incidents took place that day, and you don't shut it down, you clearly are still wanting to allow it to happen. And you can't argue that. I mean, that's what went down in July of this year.
Now, here's a question I have
about
for
you
guys.
You just said.
That's a question I have for you following that, though. We have a lawsuit now filed by the family of Timothy Reynolds in civil court that I believe they're going to win against the city of Baltimore. I don't know how much, but will it take, like, suing to actually change behavior?
I don't know. Just think about what Bryan just said. Guy was killed in the street. By a squeegee kid.
Yes.
We know they have guns. They're not taking them off the street. I mean, that is insane.
So do you have to sue? I guess what I'm saying, since we can't do it legislatively, does the courts have to weigh in order to stop this behavior?
I don't know. Can they?
Absolutely. If you get a lawsuit that not only has a monetary award, but says you can't do thus and so, that you can actually do that through the courts.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's the only thing that politicians pay attention to. And that's the other part of this. Mayor Scott doesn't see any political risk with allowing the squeegee kids to stay, because a lot of the pushback isn't coming from city residents. Like, some of it is, but most of it's, you know, Baltimore County and Anne Arundel County, people traveling into the city. He has almost no political incentive to really address it, because I don't know if he's getting a ton of pushback from within the city. I mean, when we have the conversation, a lot of people are like, well, they're not bothering me. They don't mess with me.
Be nice to them. Give them a buck.
Yeah, I mean, exactly.
Like, so, are you saying, though, that the voters aren't annoyed that they have to drive down the street in fear?
I don't think they are.
No?
I think
I know I am. I don't live in the city, but I know I am.
Well, they avoid them. Here's the thing: you avoid it. But
it's hard to avoid.
But what Tori is saying is correct. A lot of people just learn to live with it. It's almost like an abusive situation. We just learn to live with.
No, that's kind of Baltimore in general, right? A lot of people are just resigned to living here.
There's a race element to this too. I do believe, because I almost never get accosted by a squeegee kid. No. Like, they take one look at me, I glance at them and nod them off. They never. I can't remember the last time someone touched my windshield. And I don't know. Maybe they know me, right? Maybe I drive through every day.
They go to people with families. Like, they go to people because they went to judge, what's his name, with his wife.
Yeah.
They go to when it's either you're vulnerable. Like, you might have a child, or you might have a wife or somebody with you. They do know who to go after. I'm talking about aggressively.
Yeah.
They go after everybody, but it's different to aggressively.
That's the whole problem with them, though. If they weren't annoying and touching of cars and spitting on people's
cars.
They could just take a no, we wouldn't even be talking about this.
That's correct.
Wouldn't be that big of an issue whatsoever. But they do that. It has become extortion in many cases, and people are legitimately scared to go into the city because of it.
People aren't voting for Mayor Brandon Scott. Right. And I mean, if this was a political issue, right, if this was something that Baltimore City residents were upset about, he'd be dealing with
it. Well, to make Tory's point, how many council people have you heard from? How many state legislators
Costello,
have you heard from?
Right? He's the only one.
Costello and a couple of others. But I mean, really, from the whole scheme of things, how many state senators, delegates have you heard from?
None. That's why I always say, when I hear from the delegates and the senators that represent Baltimore City, then I'll know they're taking it seriously. But until that happens, I know that for the residents, like, we're upset about it.
Right.
We live in Anne Arundel County, Baltimore County, like,
into the city that are being accosted rather than people who actually live
there? Yes, I think they know how to identify them. I really do.
Well, I'm going to tell you again, 42-year-old African-American woman living in the city, she felt a need to pull a gun. She legally had the right to carry by a legal gun owner on squeegee workers at Martin Luther King in Washington.
We get callers and texters all the time, C4, though, who live in the city.
Absolutely.
Black guys who call in and say they're tired and that they go a different direction because of the squeegee.
But their voice is not being heard.
I was about to say, they're clearly not voting, or there's not enough of them, because, again, C4 said, when the council members start going before the mayor and saying you need to do something about this, like, it's like that with the violence, right? We saw the pattern. Nobody cared about the violence. Nobody took it seriously.
Until
you have the city council start
conference.
Getting up there. Now Mayor Scott's like, we've got repeat violent offenders. We got to get them off this. Like, that's the barometer, right? The politicians, when they believe that their elections are at stake because of it, then they'll
got to keep our phony baloney jobs. That's right.
Okay, but Ivan Bates did run on it, and he also has made it perfectly clear since he was elected that he is not going to allow squeegeers to stay on the streets.
Well, he was propelled on violence, though. I think that a lot of people were thinking more about the gun violence than
squeegee. He did talk about it, and the question is he going to try to make nice with Brandon Scott and the whole squeegee collaborative idea, or is he going to come in on his own and say, look, I'm going to be much more aggressive on this. I'm going to charge these kids.
Well, he's already said it. I mean, he's said it as many times as he can say it.
He can't go both ways, though. He can't go with the squeegee collaborative and then be tough on the squeegee kids.
He says he can. He said he's in there simply to hear what they have to say. That's what he told Bryan and me. But he believes it is against the law what they're doing, and he will charge them.
Good.
Is what he said.
That'll be another measure. If he starts confronting the squeegee kids, then I'll know that he is actually in there to do the job. I'm not optimistic. But there are different measures, right? There are different things that I can see, and that's one of those litmus tests, right? If he's confrontational with the squeegee kids, once he's in and we start seeing movement there, then I'll think, okay, we're starting to take this seriously.
Something has to give, though, because Ivan Bates says he's not going to tolerate it. And then he's a part of the squeegee collaborative. The squeegee collaborative has this plan where you can't do it at six intersections, and, you know, we'll pay you if you do this and that, but, you know, we're not going to enforce it in other places. So if Ivan Bates says we're not going to tolerate it, and Mayor Scott says, well, we're just going to stop it at six places, ultimately it's up to the cops to make that determination.
Exactly.
And the cops listen to Brandon Scott. They don't listen to Ivan Bates.
The question is, when that first arrest occurs, or whatever occurs with that police officer, what happens next?
Yep.
What does he do? And once I think the tone will be set with that action.
Mm-hmm. So you think the squeegee collaborative will actually stick? Will there be changes to it? Like, is it actually going to, on January 10th, right? Is that the date?
January the 10th.
Is that the date I can drive
down?
And
here's the other thing, though, Bryan. It's not even six corners. Remember the mayor told us it's not, it's an area or a zone. It's not like just six individual locations. He said, because you brought the example. What about a few
zones.
Blocks down the street?
He said zones.
He said
right.
it's a zone or
right.
something.
Well,
right.
it's going to be cold, too, when place, it goes. Though. What's going to happen, though, is it's going to be really cold and rainy when it finally goes into effect, and Brandon Scott's going to come out. See?
They're not
squeegee kids.
They're not here. It worked.
All right. Well, I'll tell you what you'll be able to do.
Success.
You'll be able to go on Twitter and tweet out where the free squeegeeing places are in the Baltimore City area, and maybe that will still be around because Elon Musk has changed the landscape of social media in a major way. We'll talk about the chief twit. Is that what he
yep.
said? That's
twit.
What we call Elon Musk. And the media in general coming up next as the Holiday Talk Star Show continues right here on WBAL.